Hello and welcome for our webinar on getting ready for ISO 20022 with Temenos Payments Hub. My name is Saurabh and I am the moderator for today's webinar. A few guidelines for today's webinar. The session will be for 60 minutes. The first 45 to 50 minutes, the speaker will talk on the topic, followed by Q&As. We encourage you to submit your text questions to today's presenter by typing your questions into the question pane in the GoToWebinar control panel. You can send in your questions at any time during the session. We will collate these and post them to the presenter towards the end of the session. For your information, today's webinar is getting recorded and you will be notified via email within 48 hours. This will be also available in Maverick's website within 4 working days. Now, let me introduce you to our speaker for today. We have Premnath Devaraj, also addressed as Prem, works as TPH consultant at Maverick System. Prem has a long association in the payments world. He has more than 17 years of experience in retail and corporate banking domain. He is a subject matter expertise in retail banking payments and credit cards, and has 2 years of experience in Temenos practice as Temenos Payments Consultant. Now, I'll hand it over to Prem and he will take it from here.
Thanks, Saurabh. Hello, everyone. A warm greetings to all. So I'm Premnath Devaraj, TPH Consultant with Maverick. I'm happy to take you all through the topic getting ready for ISO 20022 with Temenos Payments Hub. By sharing my knowledge, I hope this session would be very useful and informative. The agenda for this session would be a gist about the latest payment developments and what would be the global payments requirement and impact on the market due to these developments. With this, what is the implication for the bank and what is our recommendations? Then we will get into the product or TPH, where we'll see the overview, its key features of TPH, and the deployment modes of TPH, and finally on the unmatched benefits of TPH. So when we say payments, it is primarily focused on retail, corporate, and wealth management side. So though all these payment developments are more familiar to all, we tried to emphasize on the key changes, which is very relevant to the topic. The fact is, the payments language of the future is arrived. So we can say for years, the formats supporting the high value payment systems and cross-border payment systems have been fractured. So this is basically due to different standards and formats. And because of this, there is a significant delay and the systems are not efficient enough to process these types of payments. So the financial service industry has to migrate to one common language. So now, which is ISO 20022. And this is now termed as the new global standard for payment messaging. In fact, the announcements are made very clear by the payment market infrastructures on the migration of this ISO 20022 over the next few years, which actually marks the biggest move. And also, all the major RTGS and high value payment systems has to move to ISO 20022. So why ISO 20022 and what is the rationale behind this moving into an ISO compliant? Because it is very rich, structured, and it has an extensible messaging standard. So by this, which is increasingly becoming a de facto standard for exchange of payments. And it has very much richer information than the earlier SWIFT MT messages and other legacy formats. So we can say it has rich structured party data, extended remittance information, allows for special characters and expanded character sets, and it has full information on the payment parties. With this, ISO promises to lay the foundation for the greater payment processing efficiency, improved customer experience, and a streamlined compliance procedure. And these features actually pave the way towards the higher level of automation, and in fact also reduces the cost and has a better reconciliation. Along with this ISO compliant, that the payment industry is continuously evolving with the changes driven by various businesses like say we have open banking, we can see the RTGS systems getting renewed and so many emerging instant payments coming up. So with all these facts, if we round up to see what would be the global requirements for the payment systems, it would be like, yes, of course, the first, it's ISO 20022 adoption, because it's becoming the unified payment standard. Secondly, the capability of handling payment related services. So like, say we have SWIFT API, request to pay, confirmation on pay, and open banking APIs. And in fact, all the SWIFT GPA products will be available in ISO. And in fact, CBPR group, along with their GPI expert groups, enable all the GPA services on ISO 20022. And in fact, in open banking API also, as per PSD2 regulated technical standard, the financial message for communication between banks mention ISO 20022 message format. The next requirement is the payment system should be able to support the domestic instant payment schemes. So these instant payments comes with a very tight time bound for processing, and this has to be at 24/7 and in real time. So if the payment systems are in a position to offer these such services to the customer as a service, then they have to handle the instant real time payments. And lastly, the system should be able to handle high volumes. This is due to the emerging instant payments, the different digital payments, and cashless payments. The volumes would be definitely be in the higher side, and the system should be in a place to handle such high volumes. Here we say the major clearinghouses and the SWIFT are planning to switch to ISO 20022. The change is driven predominantly by the SWIFT in the correspondent banking space. So here we try showcasing on the market infrastructure's migration approach with respect to the major currencies like USD and UK sterling, pound, and the euro. So the main motto is that by 2025, all the financial institutions should be able to process ISO compliant payment transactions. So SWIFT says by 2023, ISO will be the de facto standard for high-value payment systems of all reserve currencies, and which will account for 80% of the transaction volumes and 87% of the transaction values worldwide. The International Payments Expert Group, like we have High Value Payments Group and the CBPR user groups, they were actually established to harmonize the standard across the region and make the migration for cross-border payments as smooth as possible for the banks. Due to several banks voiced out their concern as they would not be able to consume ISO, and COVID-19 pandemic also being another factor, the SWIFT has revisited its approach, and this made the migration delay by 1 year from their earlier deadline of November 2021 to November 2022. But in the meantime, SWIFT has announced a new strategy, maybe around March 2020, by introducing a strategy of introduction of a central transaction management platform, which is called as TMP. So this introduction is completely aimed at reducing the cost and the complexity of ISO 20022 adoption. So from the end of 2022, the banks may use ISO 20022 based messaging, and even the API framework also uses the same to execute the payments business. So we can say the SWIFT MT category 1, 2, and 9 messages used for this cross-border and cash reporting payments will be decommissioned by November 2025. Having this on the SWIFT side, if we move to UK Eurozone, so we have Euro systems, high-value payment systems, Target 2, which will switch to ISO 20022 in a big bang migration by November 2022. So any Euro system participants which is communicating with the T2 system will be made possible only with the new format. And EBA clearing also highlights that their payment message interface specification will be fully aligned to that of T2, which is again ISO 20022 format. But due to this SWIFT migration delay, the European Central Bank was the first to react on this SWIFT delay in migration, and they announced their decision delaying its T2 and T2 consolidation project to November 2022, which is again in line with the SWIFT migration. And in the same note, EBA Clearing also confirmed their ISO migration strategy for Euro 1 and Step 2 will be in line with European Central Bank's timeline. So this is on the European market. On the UK front, the payment schemes such as faster payments and BACS, as per their new payment architecture and UK's renewed RTGS systems are also set to adopt ISO 20022 format. And again, UK's open banking initiative also specifies ISO 20022 derived API specifications. So this is to have the consistency of payments data across their payment infrastructure. But however, due to this SWIFT migration delay, the Bank of England has come with a new approach with saying that CHAPS is set to go live in June 2022 and making the UK's first payment infrastructure to migrate to new standard. On the US market, we can say the Federal Reserve Bank announced that they are likely to implement the ISO 20022 message through a big bang or by a phased approach. But however, the confirmation and the further details are not expected before 2021. So with this migration approach, let's see what is the impact on the market. So here, the path to ISO compliance has its own impact. So the payment processing functions will need to be updated and understood like on the structure or on the advice or on the support on any additional field length details or on the format of statements. So or on the information of any payment actors under the ISO. So we can say there is always a list of potential interdependencies across this initiative. So like say from channels, the corporate customers, debtor and creditor source data quality has to be updated. And we might have online payment screens, reporting tools, or payment origination forms, or the disclosure terms with respect to the payment entry screens. All these needs to be updated. And any other business-related payment sources, like say security or trade, that again has to be updated. So this is from the channels front. But when we see from the payment processing side, the high value payment system and the clearing gateway has to be updated and to identify these ISO formats, and the operation teams need to be understood and they have to update so that to have very lower manual intervention, and if they have any recurring templates and mappings, and then that has to be updated. And if we move to the infrastructure side, we might need a middleware support for processing the XML and the ISO data, ISO 20O data for processing. And the storage and bandwidth, let's say if there is a larger size of XML message required on this processing, then there will be a storage and data bandwidth need to be updated. And if there is any file transmission between any of these systems, then the format specifications which has the link between the two systems has to be updated. So with these impacts, let's see what is the implication for the bank. So here, so when we see what is the implication for the bank, it is the new standards actually gives a mandate with the near-term deadline for implementation. It's very clear that all the payment infrastructures are moving and they have a plan to transition to ISO 20022. So this makes bank to have a tab on the migration of that their own payment infrastructures. And if the banks are supporting and involving in the cross-border payments, then and they have to get ready to support with the ISO 20022. Finally, the banks might need to have a payment system which handles the very high volumes. So with these are known implications for the banks. So having this implications, so the bank has to be in a position to have a strategy to move to ISO 20022. So having this implications, so let's see what are our recommendations. So the point one is baseline the current state. So here, they have to assess the impact across the payment value chain. The bank has to assess their impact across the payment value chain. And they have to assess on ISO 20022 impacts or gaps. So what we try to say is the banks need to identify these applications involved, and they need to identify the integration or the middleware support which is required. And they need to identify the infrastructure support, and they have to assess on their operations teams and servicing and reporting tools, and they should actually try to understand the ISO and capitalize it for having any streamlined process, and if they want to have a new product and enhanced services. And third is something they have to assess on the STP rate. So because there's a structured data change coming up, so due to this change in the structured data, the bank need to assess on the STP rate and guide their customers. Yes, of course, the banks need to guide their customers. They need to understand the changes, and they need to educate the customers, saying that this ISO 20022 is a kind of a front-to-back readiness, and it is a value-added experience rather than it's a mere change. So they should be able to educate, manage, and monitor on the migration efforts. And finally, the bank has to build a target. So we say here the bank has to have a roadmap or an implementation plan. So this is all, these are on the general payment side. So having all these points on the general banking, stating that ISO is ready, and the banks has to move to this, let's go into the product TPH. So Temenos Payment Hub overview. So first thing we'll say, what is the definition of TPH? So when we define TPH, so the important point is that it is a universal payment solution. So the processing of any payment, any type of payment in one solution. So here what we try to say, or in turn what we say, is it is a uniquely flexible product which can process any type of payment. So whether it is a domestic or international, so in one solution, and in being in one solution, it has the full and real-time control over it. And this payment product can be offered to any bank of any size and at any region. So by saying all this and putting all these points, we can define TPH is a universal payment solution. Secondly, Temenos provides a harmonized payment experience, mean to say it provides the bank with 360 degree view of all transactions in real time. So this makes TPH to give a best customer experience. Added to it, TPH has the automated exception handling and intelligent routing, so which makes payment transaction to be processed without or with a minimal manual intervention, and more specifically with the support in the real time, so which drives TPH with a very high STP rates. And of course, TPH is an agile and secure product. So mean to say, the Payment Hub provides an excellent in-depth functionality. So what we try to say here is that all the business functionality in TPH is supported by a highly advanced architecture. So which makes the TPH to be very active and live on the processing of any payment. So by this, TPH reduces the risk having very minimal and manual intervention. So because it has the pre-built monitors, real-time dashboards, or control to review authorization, and with all this, it can actually identify any glitches or any bottlenecks on any payment at a very, very early stage, so that the operator can take an immediate and appropriate action. So this makes TPH to be very agile and secure payment product. So let's now look into the key features of TPH. So whatever points we've listed out here is the features of TPH. The details of these listed features are available over the coming slides. So the first feature we say is parameterizable. So actually, what we try to say is the TPH has the list of workflow components, which makes any type of payment to be processed in a specified flow. And secondly, it is very channel and format agnostic. Mean to say, TPH can process any payment from any channel to any destination. And on the format side, it can handle ISO 20022 and also support and understand the different message formats and support different message types. The next key feature is Temenos Payments has the advanced infrastructure. So by saying advanced infrastructure, it has the capability of real-time processing and handling open APIs. So let's look into detail of these features. So the first feature we say, it is parameterizable. So it has a universal payment workflow components. So in fact, this key feature is the TPH architecture, so which makes a universal solution for processing any payment from any channel and also with any format for a very optimum STP, we can say. So TPH caters all these requirements, what we have shown here, right from the payment receipt acceptance stage till to the finalization of the payment. In fact, for more understanding of these components, we can split these components into three stages. At stage one, let's have this acceptance, mapping and preparation. So here what we try to say is the TPH has the capability, it understands on the receipt of payment message, and on the receipt it tries to understand the payment message for further processing. And while it's understood, it checks whether it is a valid message for processing and if any priority is required on the payment for processing. So at this stage, once it is ready for the payment to be processed, then it moves to the stage two. So here it has to process those payment. So while processing, in case of any exceptions, it has its own automatic exception handling to take care, and it has the best routing and settlement configuration to process the payment seamlessly. And for any future payment receipt, it has the logic of Varos built in it. And it also has the capability to do a risk filter, and that is again for screening of any transactions to check on like the fraud transactions. And the final stage, once this is processed, this has to check on the fees calculation, and it has to do a FX calculation, and it automatically generates the accounting entries and finally do the finalization of the payment. And at the same time, it will be able to, it will be available, and once all this is processed, it will be available for the reports and data analytics. So this is the workflow components, which is in fact the key TPH architecture. So we can say TPH is an agnostic system, so made up of these components, which has a structured process flow for seamless processing. So this process flow has a list of components which call the components one after the other. So the main point over here is that it has the list of components which calls the component one after the other for processing, which gives more visibility on what is happening on the payment and at which stage currently the payment is lying, and we will be able to view on the payment while it is getting processed. And with this flow, it can support the growth and the volume of the transactions. And this architecture enables any payment type to be processed based on a specific rules as configured. So we can say the TPH architecture as a TPH componentized solution caters to accommodate emerging changes in the market, and all components put together process a payment transaction as per configuration. So with this key feature, let's go into the next one. So the next key feature is the format and channel agnostic. So here, what we try to say is actually TPH is built on a sophisticated centralized infrastructure, so which makes TPH to operate any payment from any format and also from any channel. So it can process high value transactions, and it can also process high volumes, and it can also prioritize the payments. So in case, let's say if the payment is prioritized, So TPH ensures it receives the relevant necessary processing details for execution. So this centralized infrastructure supports multiple message payment types, like for example for RTGS, its systems it supports on the example we shown that in the European market T2 and US Fedwire and CHAPS, and on the if it is on the clearing payment transactions like in the Europe market SEPA and UK BACS and US ACH are being supported, and on the instant payment types like it supports the SEPA credit transfer instant and FPS and tips from you, and all this has been currently being supported. So importantly, it supports the financial messaging standard used by the payment schemes globally. So here we try to say TPH can handle the ISO 20022, because the ISO 20022 is currently a major data model change, and which has a validation and it has to be applied on the data. So it has the capability to handle the ISO 20022. And also it supports the payments such as rejects, returns, refund, and then recall. All types of payments are also handled here. So we are in the picture, we tried to depict that the hub as the centralized solution, it has the capability to receive all the incoming payments, and which can be of any format, what we have seen like ISO or RTGS or any payment types, and it will be able to process accordingly. And similarly, as if it is an outgoing side, so it's capable of generating in the respective format and send it for processing. So that is what we try to picturize here, that being a TPH as a hub solution. And the next key feature is the Temenos payments is designed with real-time processing and open APIs as part of its core requirement, we can say. So the open banking is actually a revolution accompanied with the enforcement of PSD2 regulation. So in fact, Europe is the first mover, and they are more mature in open banking regime than any other markets. So for any payments, the banks are obligated to provide payment information to facilitate the payment from third parties. So because of this facilitation from third parties, this faces more regulations on the data protection. And not only the bank, it is also the third party also faces the same kind of regulations. So one of the ultimate aim of PSD2 is to have a secure digital payment services that benefits the consumers. So the PSD2 regulatory technical standard also mentions ISO 20022 is the message format as the financial messaging standard for communication to happen between any banks. And in fact, these are the dedicated interfaces and which are to be ISO compliant. So the Temenos solution architecture addresses the key challenges which are exhibited by this open banking and the PSD2. Like on the security front, the Temenos solution comes with the required components and tools, as well as with the partner solution to provide like a strong authentication, authorization, access control, and non-repudiation services. On the API side, Temenos provides the ISO compliant message equivalents of API, so which generally uses the the pain and the camp messages to perform the payment initiation services. So this again will meet the PSD2 requirements. And on being real time, the Temenos payment solution is fully a non-stop 24/7, which has the real time framework that accepts and executes the payment order. And this Temenos framework also allows bank to scale. So it allows to have higher query volumes and also respond to the request by third parties, that again in the acceptable time frames. So with this, we can say TPH supports the real time processing and open APIs. So how does TPH process a payment? So actually, TPH payments hub process the payment based on speed, payment type, and its reachability. For example, there can be a real-time instant payment, so which has to be handled via a single transaction using local currency. And added to that, it should have a strict SLA with 24/7 support being in real time, right? And in that way, it has to support the real time. And when we say it is, there can be a near real-time high-value payments like SWIFT and RTGS. So SWIFT, which has to support via different or multiple currencies, and whereas that RTGS payments with the local currencies. And again, these can be a single or bulk transaction. So TPH will be able to understand and process this accordingly. Likewise, we can also have batch payments with the local currency, local clearing settlement in local currencies. So being bulk transaction, it can be processed overnight or intraday. So TPH understand all this. So we can say by understanding all these things, TPH offers a range of proven products, so which covers the entire payment lifecycle, and the products are designed to work separately or together, and it provides a flexible payment solution specific to any individual requirements. So here the reachability check is configurable, it can have its own method of configuration for any type of clearing. So that is what we can say from this payment processing side. And Temenos as a model bank approach. So here, when we say model bank approach, the systems are delivered with pre-configured data. So the most requests can be handled by the configuration. So TPH actually adapts accordingly to the geographical formatting, and it supports the currency and also supports the respective payment schemes of that particular region. In the way, it also adapts at the phase level approach, at the region level or at the branch level, with its own flexible configuration options. In fact, we can say Temenos actually builds a standardized regional capabilities, which helps the bank to get into new businesses, business areas, and the geographies with help of this model bank approach. So now let's see what are the deployment modes available with TPH. So it can be deployed in embedded mode, or it can be deployed in the integrated mode. So again, this can be on a cloud or on premise. So when it is deployed in embedded mode, it means to say the payment processor and the accounts processor are on the same application and the database service. So here we say that Temenos Payments and Temenos Transact are in the same application and database service. So with this, the payment processor uses a synchronous calls to talk to the account service. And being an embedded mode, the advantage would be like it doesn't need to have an integration effort. So there's no integration effect. So as it is actually integrated with its own T24 core banking application. And since there is no integration effort, it is very speed to market. It will have a significant cost saving also in this. And it can have a seamless real-time experience for both the internal and the external payment users. So by this embedded mode, we can say it will be an added value for all the Temenos clients. And the other hand, being an integrated mode or as being a platform independent, the payment and the account processes are separated here, and it has the integration framework, which is used to send requests to the third-party systems of like customers and screening, etc. And here the request and response are handled in an asynchronous manner. So the advantages of being a platform independent are it can be deployed to any technical stack, and it has a proven capabilities of multi-company, multi-currency, and multi-time zone, and it minimizes the technology and platform risk, and it also has a very low cost. And here, the TPH uses the same code and the configuration base, irrespective of TPH being deployed on a cloud or on-premise. So these are the deployment modes and advantages of TPH. So here in this slide, we try to say that payments the TPH is fully integrated with several in-house products of Temenos. So which can actually make a kind of a payment lifecycle, we can say. So like the products are, so the, what are the in-house products? If we see it, like it has the Temenos compliance products, so which groups through API and other banking API. So the Temenos has the regulatory product designed to manage risk and remain compliant. And it has Temenos Infinity. So this is a digital application for retail and business banking payment. And Temenos Analytics, a business intelligent product, so which allows the bank to be more efficient by providing key data on the finance, customer, and digital part. And we have FCM, the financial crime mitigation product, which can be used for screening. So that is again for fraud verification or AML checks or KYC. This can be done through this FCM. And we have a payment order and auto repair. So the payment order is for the payment initiation and the tracking. So this payment order, auto repair, and the payment hub all put together forms a TPH family. So by having payment order covering at the front end part and the payment hub being at the back end processing. So and these are the in-house products of Temenos, and all our payment solutions can run in the embedded and the integrated mode. So this is on the general in-house products, and let's now look into what are the benefits of TPH. Uh, So in fact, when we say benefits, it's really an unmatched benefits of TPH compared to any other payment solutions. So first point, it is single solution. So TPH being available as a standalone or embedded into Temenos core banking system, we can say the payment hub is a single solution to design high value payment systems and instant payments. So they use actually the same solution or the base to have this high value payments and instant payments. So it can process all types of payments like RTGS, ACH, instant payments, SWIFT, or cross-border payments, and all this can be processed at a very reduced processing cost. So actually, by saying a single solution, we can say TPH actually simplifies the payment landscape. So that is why being it's a single solution, it simplifying the payment landscape. So this is one of the core benefit of TPH, because all the all types of payments schemes can be run in a single solution, rather having a different structure and format for different payment schemes. Second, on the intelligent routing. So the payment hub actually provides the best routing and the best routing and the processing schemes. So we saw in the list of components while it is at the processing stage. So there it actually offers various features while processing, like it has skipping of a payment, and it prioritizing a payment, and or specify a later date for execution, and we can have override changes which can be done manually, and we can also manage SLAs according to the payment types. So with all these different features, it enables the speed of settlement, eliminating the unnecessary processing and being processed in a single solution. So that is why it has the best, we can say it has the best intelligent routing, which cannot be found in any other payment systems. And it has a very, very less customization effect. So here we can say TPH is highly configurable. So it's being highly configurable, it can meet any customer requirement. So it can process a high value, it can take care of high value customers, it can take care of low value customers, and all this can be done through the configurations. So to process in such a way, TPH does not require any software changes. So that is one of the more important point. And with this, and all these changes respective of high and low care customers, the processing can be done through its own configuration. So the TPH is completely configuration driven payment workflow product. So this makes TPH deliver any business functionality. So by delivering this, it has its more in-depth functionality. We can configure in-depth functionality on that payment, and this makes TPH to be very, very flexible, and it is very less customizable. And TPH is an API enabled product. So the instructions, like let's say accepting the payment order on an account, or calculating the cost on executing the payment, or providing the payment status, and also like accepting the payment cancellation on the payment order, for all these types of instructions, TPH provides an ISO compliant message using pane and camp message. So this is again to perform that payment initiation messages. So having this, all these APIs enabled with ISO compliant, and these are executed through APIs, and this the TPH product ensures that these all meets the PSD2 requirements compliant, and which this makes the TPH an API enabled product, and all in one system. So what we try to say in all in one system is that TPH as a payment product family, so with having payment order to cover the front office demands, and auto repair for exception handling, and this improves the STP by repairing and enriching the messages, and we have payments up for the back office processing. So the payment order module actually captures this payment processing for processing, and it is highly flexible system which provides the necessary workflow for the approval of that payment order. So by this flexibility and giving an int on the approval, it makes sure or it ensures that only the valid payment order request is processed. So TPH family can have all in one, which can cover the front end demands and also as well as the back end demands. So with this, we can say TPH is completely an all in one solution. And it achieves high STP. So this is TPH is very secure and provides maximum STP. So it reduces the manual intervention. We know that. So having this model bank approach. So with this model bank approach, it delivers a pre-configured system. So this can be configured based on the specific region, and this can be configured based on the payment schemes. So since most of these requests are handled through configuration, it has the capability to achieve the high STP rate. So since it's completely the configuration driven product with respect to any region or with respect to payment schemes, see, the configuration can be done on all the list of components which is available, and this and doing this configuration over the components as per the requirement, it has the capability to high STP rate. And with this, we try to make sure that there is no manual intervention is required for any of that payment schemes. And it is a future-proofed payment hub. So this is the important benefit and highlight of the TPH. So here we say that it covers the demand of today and tomorrow. So mean to say the Temenos Payment Hub as a payment platform, it addresses the expectation of any global payment mechanisms, and it can address the expectation of any emerging instant payments, and it can address the expectation of any payment schemes. And here we try to emphasize more important that it currently addresses the expectation of ISO 20022. So it has the ability to understand the data model change. It has the ability to do a validity on that data. And with this, we can say TPH is best suited for the banks. So if, let's say, if any bank or rather for any bank where the payment is the key business, then TPH is the best suit for that payment, because it gives the full ISO 20022 support for all its financial transactions. So focused on compliance. So here the TPH is completely focused on compliance. So it provides the regulatory compliance and key market standard changes will always be applied to all the Temenos solutions. So example, for TPH, it covers through the, for at a country level, the compliant is met through the clearing framework, and at the wider angle, we can say it for example, it meets all the PSD requirement needs. So and finally, the biggest benefit is the Temenos infrastructure. So the Temenos infrastructure itself is a big key benefit, because we saw it has a universal flow workflow components. So this being configurable, this enables the payment to be processed on a specific rule, and it can roll out or support any new payment schemes as and when it is coming up. So without any changes into it, but just by doing it through the configuration, and all this also with all this, it can also maintain a compliance based on this parameterizable component. Again, this whatever compliant need also is a configuration part which is available in this components. And with this, the Temenos infrastructure is completely a biggest boom and a benefit for the payment system, I can say. So this is on the benefits of TPH. So finally, so what is the conclusion by looking into all this? We say is TPH is the finest suit for payment processing solutions. So by saying this, we say it supports the digital payments capability. So here an infrastructure designed to support digital customers. And ISO 20022, which is very, very more important benefit because it supports the ISO 20022 initiative by maintaining a regulatory compliance pertaining to any region. And it supports the new instant payments and new market services because TPH uses the API first payment technology, which has the latest standards for integration. So this supports the or accepts all the new market services and new instant payments. And finally, the TPH is deployable on premise in the cloud and as a service. And with the TPH being growing customer base, it has been rated on top by the payment analyst. So with this, I end this webinar, and thanks so much all for hearing me out on the insights whatever I have shared, and over to you, Saurabh, for any question and answers.
Thank you, Prem, for sharing insights on getting ready for ISO 20022 with Temenos Payments Hub. We are now ready to move on to the Q&A part of our session. I want to remind you that you can still submit your questions through the question pane in the GoToWebinar control panel. So moving on to the first question. So payment requirements come from various regions. How does TPH support these payments from being region specific? I'll repeat that again for you. Payments requirement come from various regions. How does TPH support these payments from being region specific?
Okay. So we saw that TPH is has a model bank approach. And if you see, TPH is actually seen the historical needs from different regions, and also they have the rules will continuously change until the launch of that payment schemes in the with respect to that region. So the TPH has a good understanding of on all such needs. So it in fact it has a sufficient alert, I can say, on all these changes. So with this, we can say that TPH has the capability to adapt to that new changes and make this requirements to be available immediately on the product without any impact on having the service. So when we say it is having a regional functionality, we can say that TPH has the functionality for over 150 countries across the world, and with a model bank framework, it will be very easy and to adapt and cover any region specific requirements.
Moving on to the next question. So how different are these standards different from dual messaging systems and ATM FRM capabilities from T24 perspectives? How different are these standards different from dual messaging system and ATM FRM capabilities from T24 perspectives?
Can you repeat it again? Sorry.
Yeah, sure, Prem. So the question is, how different are these standards different from dual messaging systems and ATM FRM capabilities from T24 perspective?
Okay, so let me try to understand and give a better explanation for this answer this question separately maybe.
Okay, sure, we'll take this later. The next question is ISO 20022 versus ISO 8583. How different are these standards?
Okay, so ISO 20022 is a completely new standard which is coming up on the which we can say an enhanced payment scheme, payment messaging standard which is coming across globally. So the ISO 8583 is an existing one. I am not sure on much about on that 8583, and which is an existing one, but ISO 20022 is the very, very basic standard functionality which is coming across for the high value payments and cross-border payments. So it with this standard, they're trying to bring in all the services. Like, let's say we have Swift GPI services and other services, which is respect to the which is very very respective to the communication between the banks, I can say. So in that perspective, ISO 20022 leads the margin for transferring the payments.
So we have just got another question. So what impact there would be in case of new clearing house to be used by TPH? What impact there would be in case of new clearing house to be used by TPH?
No, I don't see any impact on using a new clearinghouse. See, as long as when there is clearinghouse which takes care of the payment transformation between the bank and the clearing of the payment, so it goes with any specific format. So any clearinghouse has to go with the standard formats. So if it is the country specific format and it uses any specific country specific format, then already TPH might have, if it is available in that respective region, it is handy for TPH to use that format. Or else if it's a standard ISO format, it is very very handy, because TPH already has that ISO format to have that ISO compliant. So I don't specifically see any change because of this new clearinghouse coming, because anyway when the payment is coming in, they should have a standard for communicating between the clearing and the banks.
Thanks, Prem. I want to remind you that you can still submit your questions through the question pane in the GoToWebinar control panel. So moving on to the next question, has ISO 20022 anything to do with XRP crypto? Has ISO 22 anything to do with XRP crypto?
So there are still evaluations going on with respect to the cryptocurrency for the payments, but I can say it is on a very very initial level at the design levels, and now the product, I'm not sure before saying that, but I can still say that the product is not still equipped to handle the digital currencies like Bitcoins or any other cryptocurrencies. And it has, so the logic behind having a cryptocurrency for the payments and this ISO format, actually still it's a kind of what we can say is, it's not very clear, and we cannot give an open statement as it goes with ISO statement, or is it going to have a different logic, because the cryptocurrency handling in different countries at a different way of acceptance, because in certain countries they don't even accept the cryptocurrency. So I don't see anything with ISO to crypto.
Thanks, Prem. Moving on to the next question, is TPH part of core banking product or separately licensed component for payments? Is TPH part of core banking product or separately licensed component for payments?
Okay, so TPH can be a core banking. So see, it is we saw the deployment modes, right? So it is can be deployed with its own T24 core banking, or it can be a separate product or a platform independent. So if the bank has to adopt TPH as a platform independent payment product, then it has to be a separate license component, or else it goes with a Temenos core banking, and whatever license it has to be applied for, that has to be taken.
Now moving on to the next question, do you publish open API specifications for TPH or the other standards than PSD2? Can they be freely consulted online? And how many requests per second can this API process? So I'll divide these questions into three parts. So I'll repeat the first question for you. Do you publish open API specifications for TPH or the other standards than PSD2?
So when we say, so we saw that it is an API enabled product. So see, let's with respect to TPH, since we have that open API available, so where this published APIs can be come for that respective payment initiation messages. So let me, I'm not pretty sure about how many APIs that TPH can handle on now, for at least for the transaction payment initiation and processing of that payment and having a status on that transaction, those APIs are right away available. But on your question specific to other standards than PSD2, right now TPH is completely PSD2 compliant, and if at all any other standards are compliant with respect to European region or any other, if this question pertains to any other region, then if they have that compliant, we need to recheck with the Temenos Payment Hub product people. And okay. The second question is, they can be freely.
Second part was, can they be freely consulted online?
I am not pretty sure about that. Maybe we will check this and come back on that.
Yeah, sure. We'll move on to the next question. So, ISO 20022 will replace SWIFT. Will ISO 20022 replace SWIFT?
Yes, so that is the biggest migration approach, because the SWIFT empty messages by 2025, they will be mostly decommissioned. So by, let's say by end of 2025-26 or by starting of 2026, it is assumed that all financial transaction has to go through ISO compliance. So it should, the SWIFT will be of empty will be no more.
Yeah, so there's another question. For ISO 20022, does it still need to be configured as a part of INTRF dot mapping or separate module TPH? I'll repeat for you again. So for INTO22, does it still need to be configured as a part of INTRF dot mapping or separate module of TPH?
So maybe we can take this question offline, because we are not more getting into the technical part of the product. So this is completely to make people understand that it can support, and how it supports in through the technical configurations and all is not part of this actually on this webinar. So maybe we can take this offline.
Yeah, sure, Prem. So. Whatever questions are left unanswered, please be assured of our response, which will be emailed to you in the next 48 hours. So now I'd like you to thank each one of you and appreciate your time for our webinar today. Just to remind you once again, we will share the webinar recording to all the registrants through a follow-up email in the next 48 hours. Also, this webinar recording would be available in our website in the next 4 working days. Thank you and have a great day.